So now I would like to discuss App Engine architecture and services. So before I get started, I'd like to warn you one thing. Google App Engine can be dangerous for developers because it can change your life. You know, I found that I no longer was interested in ordinary, traditional web application technology anymore. After the App Engine project, I had to build another typical MySQL kind of web server with applications, and I was so tired of doing that, you know? So this job is very dangerous and will change the way you approach web application development. In this lesson, I'd like to discuss about three things. One is the scalability and reliability that's provided by Google App Engine. And I'd like to compare that between the traditional way of designing web applications and the App Engine design. I'd also like to discuss two major components that are running inside the App Engine stack. One is the front end and how the front end works, and another is the app server and how it works. Okay, the first topic, designing for scale and reliability. So here's an excellent example of an App Engine application that's called Realtime Earthquake Monitor, and it's built by the NIED developed by the public sector in Japan. This is the actual app running. You can see that there are many blinking dots, blue dots or green dots on the map of Japan. Each dot represents the acceleration of the ground surface right now in Japan. So if you're having an earthquake right now, you'll be seeing yellow or red dots will be spreading out all over that region. And I have another demonstration that shows you how it worked in the 3.11 disaster we had last year. So you'll be able to see red and yellow dots spreading out from the northern part of Japan. Yes, that's what happened on the 3.11 disaster we had. So let's discuss how the app is designed for this kind of system. So this system is built with the App Engine as well as the data center, which is hosted by the NIED. It has many sensors on the surface of the ground all over Japan, and all the metrics will be collected by them at the data centers for us where they can create an image file. They ping and publish it in the Google App Engine every 1 second. And then the client, the browsers, the users are polling that image every 2 seconds. So that means at peak rate, since there are about 20,000 people, the App Engine will be getting about 10,000 requests per second at peak. So what are the important requirements for this app? We can summarize these as scalability, reliability, and cost efficiency. So scalability, because this side will be getting a spike of traffic in the event of the earthquake, so it has to provide more scalability than your ordinary website. And also it has to provide these so high of a reliability because the people will be using the site only when they have the disaster. If you're connecting to the site and it's down because of the disaster, then it doesn't mean anything. And also it has to be more efficient on cost. If you're preparing for the old hardware resources that will be required to provide the scalability, then it means that almost all the time that hardware resource will be resting. Nobody's connecting using that. So you have to be scalable enough to provide enough server resources, but you don't have that much money to buy all the hardware resources itself. So how do we design a web service like that that's scalable and reliable? This is how you'd do it in a traditional way of web application design. Because it should be reliable and scalable, you may have multiple instances of Apache with a server or MySQL instances. But if you have a single hardware failure on the server, that should fail over instantly. It means you also have to be prepared for load balances or reverse proxies. And we'd need to buy two or three of them. And if you have a traffic spike, then the load should be balanced among the multiple instances of the server. And if you are handling big data, and if it's growing rapidly, then it means you have to have multiple MySQL, and you have to design a sharded MySQL instance. And this can be very hard. If you have experience developing this, then you know you have to configure and test everything, every possible pattern. What if you have a failure on the reverse proxy? What if you have multiple failures on your web servers? You have to configure and test them all. And don't forget that you have to hire the people who have this experience. It all costs so much. So App Engine provides them all, allows you to build that kind of cluster and encapsulate it in an App Engine application, all running on Google's data centers. You don't need to administer that anymore. Like, if you have a hardware failure on one server, your application will not stop at all. If you have a traffic spike, the app service automatically will add more instances on demand based on the daily number of the request. If you're having so much big data that it's growing rapidly, automatically data stores will be splitting your data into multiple shards of data store servers. And you can start using App Engine without any money up front. You don't need to hire expensive administrators to operate this massive cluster. After migrating onto App Engine, you don't have to have a dedicated, experienced Linux administrator anymore, and let them focus on the more business essential thing to do. To appreciate this App Engine design more fully, you have to understand what is the design goal behind the App Engine stack. It's not just a hosting environment, and it's not just a data center. Google App Engine encourages you to use Google's best practices to design your applications. So if you have experience on producing a project that's using App Engine, you may have noticed that there are certain restrictions, rules, and practices to follow, but these are important best practices to make your application design in the googly way, scalable and reliable, like the non-relational data model. When you're using data store, not Cloud SQL or MySQL instances, you have to design your data model that can be sharded. And sometimes you may want to use the techniques like in data normalization. That may sound like a downside, but if you are an experienced web application developer, you probably realize that this is actually a best practice to make any scalable and reliable website. So the most important point is that you have to make your application portable and fine-grained. By designing your application in this way, you can use the whole data center as the computer. You are not writing your code on a specific server anymore. You are writing code for the data center or the group of data centers. You may notice when you're using these APIs, like data store APIs or Memcache with App Engine, that these APIs are abstracting a whole bunch of data centers. It's not just an API running on a single server. So in that way, you can utilize the server resources at a very high utilization rate. That ultimately means you get significantly lower total cost of ownership. You can leverage the scale of economy because your App Engine is sharing exactly the same Google infrastructure that's used by other Google services, such as Google Search or Maps. Google's SREs, or Site Reliability Engineers, will be watching your systems 24/7. And actually, Google SREs are one of the premium roles in Google's entire company. It's very hard to hire these kind of people. So to utilize and realize benefits, getting benefits from those goals or design principles behind the App Engine stack, you have to understand how things are working inside the Google App Engine stack. Now I'd like to go deeper and dive into the two major components. One is the front end and the other is the app server, these parts right here. So now to the second topic, how the front end works. Actually, I really like this diagram because it tells so much to me about what's happening inside the App Engine stack. So we'll refer back to it throughout this lesson. What benefits would the front end provide? So here you have the actual graph that I have taken from the Earthquake Real-Time Monitor applications. And you can see that the number of requests per second on the site is getting most of the time. It's around 1,000 requests per second if you're not having an earthquake or event. So it's still a very big number of requests. And you can see the blue line. This is actually the number of requests routed to the application instance. It's like 1/10 or 1/12. There's a huge difference, and it means that you don't have to pay for this difference. You can just pay for the blue request. So how do they do that? Earthquake site broadcasts the image to thousands of users without handling all the requests by the app. How can you do that? So the secret is in the front end. In the front end component, there are actually two different components. One is called the Google front end, and another thing is called the App Engine front end. And Google Frontend resides in a data center which is closest to the user. So if you have global users, then all the data centers worldwide we have in each region will be accepting requests from those users because we have so many close relationship pairings. Our relationship with the major ISPs, most of the request users will be sending to us will be accepted, received by the closest data center. And Google's front end is running inside that data center. And that's shared by most of the other Google services like a Google Search or Google Maps. And it also has the edge caching capabilities. This is the key technology. And afterwards, because it's received by Google, that request will be routed to other data centers that's running the actual App Engine services. We have Google's fiber backbone, so it will be routed fast. And that second data center is running another front end called our App Engine front end that will provide the load balancing among the multiple instances of the app servers as well as the static servers. So here the key points are edge caching and load balancing. So how do you enable the edge caching feature? There are two ways of using edge caching. One is setting the cache control header on your HTTP request. Then another one is using the static content configuration. You can just set these kinds of headers and set the expiration period, like whatever amount you want, to tell Google's front end to cache the content. And also there's another way that you can define a static content. So if you have a static HTML file or an image file on your applications, those are all served by the app server, from an app server to the browsers. So it costs you. Instead, you can define a static content like this in the configuration file so that all the content will be served by the static servers. So the last topic is how the app server works. Now let's look at the app server in detail. What if the app server can dynamically increase the number of your app instances based on the load you get? And the App Engine developer needs to know how you can control it and get the best cost, performance, efficiency. The app server is our server that provides our runtime environment for your application instances, just like the virtual machines. Like when you're deploying a new application on App Engine, the app master will initially ask app servers to host that particular application. And if your application is getting many requests from users, then the App Master directs app servers to have more application instances to scale out. And also, App Master tells the App Engine front end the location of the app server where your application is running. So the App Master orchestrates the whole load balancing or scaling out, whereas the app server provides runtime environment for the application instance. Application instances in App Engine is very similar to virtual machines, and also, just like in virtual machines, has a dedicated memory for your application. But the biggest difference is it's fully managed. You don't have to bear the burden of managing the whole operating system or application stack. You don't have to care about what version of the device driver you're using or what kind of security patches you've applied to the OS or what versions of the libraries or application services you're using. You don't have to queue them all up. Everything's taken care of by Google, so that's the huge difference. And also importantly, if you're running always inside the virtual machine, there's a certain big overhead for that because you're running different OS images on different virtual machine instances. It has a certain overhead, like it can be an overhead in terms of the CPU hours, for example. So application instances in App Engine doesn't have that overhead, and also it's fully managed. You have to understand there are two different types of application instances. One is a front-end instance, and another is a back-end instance. And front-end instance is suitable for processing short-lived requests, like when you click a button on your web application, and your request should be handled within a few seconds. Those kinds of requests should be handled by the front end, generally. Instead, backends should be used for long-lived requests, like batch processing, that should be running during the night, or if the process would take 10 minutes or tens of minutes. And front-end instances will be dynamically created and deleted. It means you can minimize the cost of the CPU hours, where the back-end instances will be statically, not totally statically, there are some dynamic characteristics of the backend instance too, but it can be a higher cost value front-end instance. Front-end instances, as you may know, there's a big limitation, the 60-second limitation on that. So you have to design your systems to process everything, to process every request within 60 seconds. And also you want to make your application in a stateless design, whereas the backend instance, there's no limit for response time. So you can spend like tens of minutes to handle a single request. And you can rely on the statefulness of the server instance. But currently, we are having the separation between them. And I'd like to show you how the front-end instance will be scaling out. App Engine are watching the status of the pending request queues that's held by each application instance. Each application instance has a queue that will be holding the request from the users. So if you're getting a spike of traffic, that means the queue will be filled up with many requests. In that case, the App Engine detects it and is trying to add more and more front-end instances. Once you've processed all the requests from the queue, then App Engine tries to reduce the number of front-end instances. So dynamically scaling out and scaling in. And the important thing to notice is that there are two important parameters. One is the pending latency, and the other is idle instances. What is pending latency? Pending latency is the time to hold the largest in the pending queue before creating a new instance. It means if you are setting a very short time period to these parameters, then App Engine will be creating more and more instances instantly without waiting for a certain amount of time. If you're setting this amount to be a very big amount, like 15 seconds, then your application can respond slowly. Plus, you can save your cost for the instance hours. So you can have a balance between the trade-offs, between the cost and the responsiveness. Also, there's another important parameter called idle instances, which is the number of the instances you will be having even if your application is not getting any requests from users. If you set this number to something like 10 instances, 10 idle instances, then it means even if you're getting no requests from users, there'll be 10 application instances running all the time. It will cost you higher, but it can respond to the sudden spike of traffic much more quickly. How long would it take for creating a new instance? Whenever a server tries to create a new application instance, the app server will actually be reading the .class file or the .py file of the application loading it to the instance and do the initialization. Normally, it would be under 1 second. But if you're using so many libraries throughout, then sometimes, like using the Spring framework, for example, it sometimes takes 30 seconds or 60 seconds. And you'll be seeing exceptions in that case. So every App Engine developer has to be careful about the loading request and what latency you will get when your application will be instantiated. Key takeaways. App Engine encapsulates all the costs and the effort to build scalable and available applications on its cluster. It's not just a hosting platform. It's a platform that encourages users to design your system in Google's best practices for scalability and reliability. The front end provides the edge caching and load balancing. These are very important technologies to utilize. And the app server controls the scalability of the front end instance and the back end instances. Pending latencies and idle instances are key parameters to use for controlling that behavior.